You're an ACLS team leader who has been presented with a conscious and alert 55-year-old male. As you interview the patient, you ask him how he's feeling. The primary assessment reveals that he is responsive, has an open airway, but he's experiencing shortness of breath. You learn that the patient was watching TV when the symptoms started, and that was about 3 hours ago. The patient is now complaining of chest pain, pressure in the chest, shortness of breath, and you can tell he's very diaphoretic. We know that the patient has a pulse and is breathing, so the next step is to check for more in-depth vital signs. As a team leader, you ask another available team member to attach the blood pressure cuff and place the patient on an O2 sat monitor. A more detailed pulse check is taken, and a respiratory rate and temperature is assessed. Now, even before the vital signs are recorded, a first drug may be given to the patient with a suspected heart attack. And that first medication is aspirin. First, you'll want to ask the patient if they're allergic to aspirin or if the patient has problems with gastrointestinal bleeding. Keep in mind, there's a difference between aspirin sensitivity and having an anaphylactic reaction to something like aspirin. And stomach upset doesn't really qualify for gastrointestinal bleeding. So just keep those things in the back of your mind. And if the patient responds yes to either of those questions, then aspirin may be actually contraindicated. But in this scenario, we're going to say that the patient does not have an allergy and there are no gastrointestinal bleeding problems. In this case, the correct dose is given somewhere between the range of 160 to 324 milligrams of chewable aspirin. In our scenario, we give the patient 324 milligrams of chewable aspirin. The team member now has the vital signs and tells you that the patient's pulse is 124 beats per minute. It's regular, while respirations are at 22 and the blood pressure is 140 over 90. The skin is cool and pale and the O2 sat is 92%. Now, based on this information, we decide that the patient is stable at the moment. But one thing to keep in mind is that the goal for oxygen therapy is to titrate the amount given in order to achieve at least 94% saturation. It's not necessary and is potentially even harmful to use high-flow oxygen to bring the O2 sat higher. High-flow oxygen therapy can reduce cardiac output and stroke volume, and it can also cause vasoconstriction at a time when we especially need vasodilation. Oxygen is not recommended for an O2 sat reading that is about 94% or greater. Now, since our patient has an O2 sat of 92%, it would be appropriate to start a low flow amount of oxygen via nasal cannula, and we're going to do that at between 2 and 4 liters per minute. Now, that the basic vital signs are known and the oxygen has been established, it's important to get a 12-lead ECG on this patient. Now, this is going to help us in assessing the need for fibrinolytic therapy. Within the first 10 minutes of being seen by a healthcare provider, a 12-lead ECG, a targeted history, and a physical exam all need to be done to assess whether or not fibrinolytic therapy is appropriate. Now, when assessing the 12-lead ECG, an ST elevation or depression would create a strong suspicion for injury or ischemia. In our scenario, however, it looks like a normal sinus rhythm. And at this time, it's important to gain IV access to draw blood to send to the lab. A good choice would be an 18-gauge IV with normal saline at a TKO rate. Now, since the patient is still having chest pain and the blood pressure is above 90 systolic, nitroglycerin should be administered. Before giving nitroglycerin, it's important to ask if the patient has taken any erectile dysfunction drugs or any other medications that would behave in a vasodilation way within the last 24 to 48 hours. If the patient has nitroglycerin, would be contraindicated. Now, if the patient can have nitro, it's given in a 0.4 milligram tablet or spray sublingually, and can be repeated every 5 minutes for pain as long as the blood pressure remains above 90 systolic. You would tell the patient that you're going to give a tablet of nitroglycerin to dissolve under the tongue and that it should help with the pain. It wouldn't be wrong to tell them that they might actually develop a little bit of a headache with it or that it tingles under the tongue as normal side effects. It's important to monitor the patient closely to look for changes in status. The level of the chest pain and the blood pressure need to be assessed at least every 5 minutes which we call serial vitals, in order to consider additional doses of nitroglycerin. In our scenario, the patient's pain is still at about an 8 out of 10, and the blood pressure is 120 over 88. It would be recommended to administer a second dose of nitro at 0.4 milligrams sublingually. It would also be appropriate to run another 12 lead to see if there are any changes that have occurred. The most important interventions early on for acute coronary syndrome patients are to provide adequate oxygenation, administer pharmacological interventions to reduce pain and anxiety, perform a timely assessment using a 12-lead EKG, history, and blood labs. The patient needs to be evaluated early for the possibility of fibrinolytic therapy. Cath lab consideration for percutaneous coronary interventions known as PCI, or to be transferred for continued care at a cardiac unit.